class. But in case of Java, if you declare some attribute or method in with a static keyword, then that enables you to call the attribute or the methods from outside the class without creating the object of the class. Okay, so this is the second glitch. So first glitch is,
ma'am. So the ma'am, second glitch ta bujhte parlam na.
Second glitch ta bujhte parli na. Okay.
Na.
The concept of the Java is the concept of object orientation. In any object oriented programming, we have a concept like. Just let me write it. So you have a prototype, that is a class. You have defined the class somewhere. You have written some attributes. You have written some methods. Now, if you want to use it, class is actually a virtual thing. That is a design, like a blueprint of a building. So you have the design, but you don't have the building. Now, if you want to make it physical, if you want to make it existing, so what you have to do, you have to instantiate the class. So this is your class. Now you are going to instantiate it so that you are making an object. Fine. And after making the object,
yes, ma'am.
After making the object, whatever is the name, through the say object's name is O1, O2, and class name is C1. Okay. Now through this O1, and you have the attribute like A1, A2, you have methods like M1, M2. So when you are trying to access this A1, A2, M1, M2, so what you have to do, through this object, this dot is a reference, which is actually understanding that what will come afterwards. So that is a part of this O1 object. Okay. So if you write O1.A1, that means now you're enabling this A1 to exist and you can access the value of A1. Okay. Similarly, if you write O2.A2, that means through this object, you are actually calling this A2. Exactly like the structure. When you declare something like struct s int a int b, something like this. So if you want to access this a and b, what you have to do? You have to instantiate the structure. You have to create a structure type of variable. And through that structure type of variable, you can access this a and b. So what you write? Struct s1. And you write s1.a. Exactly the same concept is here. Okay. So if you are trying to access these things which are defined inside the class, you have to instantiate the class. You have to make the object first. And after, through that object, you can call all these things present over here. Okay. So this is for the perfect or purely object-oriented programming. But in case of Java, there are some methods and variables. There may be some methods and variables which are declared with a keyword struct, which are declared with a keyword struct, static. And if they're static, then you need not to create this object. These things are not required. You just directly call those things with the class name. Suppose this M1 is declared as static. So if you want to access this M1, you just need to write C1.M1. So this becomes a property of the class. We'll come to that when we'll be learning the static variable, static keyword. Okay. So for now, it will be sufficient. If something is declared as static, that means the class name itself will be sufficient to call it. You need not to create any object. You need not to create an object, and through that object, you have to call that particular method or that particular variable. It not be mandatory for the static type of variable or method. Okay. So that is the second glitch. If it is declared as static inside the class, so it can be accessed without creating an object of it. You need not to create object of the class, and you can directly access it. Okay, so these are the two things that makes the Java not fully object-oriented technology or not object-oriented programming. Okay, fully object-oriented language, we have given the example, Smalltalk, Squawk, Self, Frau, these are the fully object-oriented programming languages. All other languages, which are minimum having that integer float, that kind of a concept, that by default will make it partially object-oriented. Okay, int, float, these are not objects. You are directly using it like this, int a, double b. So when you can write something like this, this a and b, these are not objects. These are only simple variables that you have already used in C programming. Okay, so that glitch is already there. And apart from that, you have the static type of variable and methods, which can be very easily used with a class name. You need not to refer it with objects. So these are the two problems of the Java that makes it partially object-oriented language. Okay, so if the question comes, is Java purely object-oriented? Support your answer. So in that case, this entire thing you have to write. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let us go to the next slide, that is bytecode and platform independence. Java is object-oriented. Many more such type of languages were already there before Java. But Java is very famous. What is the major important thing that makes the Java that popular? So that is its platform independence. So platform means it is a combination of the operating system and the hardware. Okay, this combo we call it as a platform. So on an Intel machine, which is loaded with Windows operating system, you have done a Java code, you have compiled it, you have created the executable. Now you have transferred the executable only, not the source code, remember this, to a Apple laptop, and you are trying to execute it over there. So obviously you can see the platform is hugely different. So in that case, if you have done this with the C program, you cannot run it. If you have done this with C++, you cannot do it. But in case of Java, this is possible. That is, compilation will be done on different platform and execution will be done on the different platform. So this nature of a programming language, we call it platform independence. And Java codes are platform independent. The source code file compiled on any platform, I told you the platform is a combination of OS and hardware. Do not take any one as a platform. If hardware is different, but the OS is same, then also the platform will different. If the OS is different and the same hardware, then also the platform will be different. Okay. So, if the Java is compiled, a Java code is compiled on any platform that can be ported to any other platform and can be executed there directly. So you need not to open your source code everywhere. If you have a C code and you are going to execute it to some other machine, so what you have to do? You have to port the entire source code and then you are revealing your source code to other person. And that will be actually opening your programming technique that you have employed over there. So it will not be secure. It will actually not be possible if it is done for some industrial purpose. Okay. So in case of Java, it is possible. How? You have a source code in some different machine, in your home machine or your office machine. And then you are porting the executable part only, which and no one will be able to understand what was the initial source code for it. Okay, so that is a huge advantage. And when we are trying to access the codes through the internet, or you have the source and the executable present in some remote machine in the World Wide Web, and through the www, you are trying to access it from some other location. So obviously this security is a very important part of our industry. And that makes the Java hugely popular programming language. Now, how it is actually being possible? So this is the workflow, how the Java program is basically executed. You can see here, it is starting with the Java source code. You are writing the Java source code under a file which should be having the extension of .java. Okay, so something you have written, some code you have written for Java program, and you have saved it under a .java file. After having that, this source code needs to be compiled. So you need to have JDK or Java Development Kit through which you have to compile it. So it is called the Java compiler. After the compilation is done, a new file is going to be generated. After a successful compilation, remember this, if it is a unsuccessful compilation, if you have a programming problem, in that case, it will show you the error like other compiler does. After solving the errors, recompile it. And when it is a successful compilation, then you are going to get another extra file. That extra file is having an extension of .class. Okay. So we call it the Java bytecode. The extension of the file is .class. Now, this is should be noted. If in your .java file, you have a single class, then you will be getting only one .class file under it with the same name of the class present in your file. Suppose you have written first.java. This is the name of your source code. I'm writing it here for your easier understanding. First.java. Suppose this is the name of your source code under which you have written class A. So after a successful compilation, as a new file, it will generate a.class, not first.class, a.class, whichever is the name of the class with the same name, a .class extension will be added, and this is your bytecode. Got it? Now, if someone is having multiple files present in this single source code, like class A, class B, something like this, it can happen. You can have any number of files. You can have any number of files or any number of classes present under the same source code. Now after compilation, you will be getting those many number of .class files, those many number of classes are there. So in this case, it will generate a.class as well as b.class. Got it? So after compilation, .class files will be created, which are called the bytecode, and how many different number of classes are there inside the source code, those many number of separate .class files will be created with the same name with the classes present under it. Okay. So,
yes, ma'am.
So after this, these bytecodes will be the executable code. But I have a problem to call it exe. These are not equivalent with the exe. Why? Because exe runs directly. Exe are direct machine level language and they can run directly. But this cannot run directly. The executable files that you generate under this dot class, they need to be interpreted. Okay. Now, when you have a JVM present in your system, that is Java interpreted, and that is called the Java virtual machine. Then through that interpreter, your .class files are going to be executed. Okay. So these are the steps that you have to follow to run a Java program. First, you program it under .java file, that is going to be your source code. After that, you compile it with your JDK, Java Development Kit, and you get .class files, which are the bytecode. The bytecodes are further interpreted through Java Virtual Machine or JVM, and then the things will run. Okay. Now, here is the important thing. These .class files, you can port to any other platform, and if that platform is having a JVM present inside it, it can run the class file then and there. It will never check for in under which circumstance it was being compiled and under which circumstance it is being executed. It need not to know that thing. So wherever you have compiled it, you port your code to any machine, and if the machine is having the JVM, it can run it. Okay. So suppose for the first time, if you have bought a computer or a laptop, and first time you have opened the internet, you are connected to the internet and trying to access some Java-enabled concept. So it will ask you that JVM should be downloaded or not, a JRE or runtime environment should be created or not. Otherwise, the Java-enabled things you cannot run or you cannot see. So you give a permission, the JVM will be downloaded. It is not containing JDK. Remember one thing, JVM, if you're only downloading JVM, it is only for execution of the Java code, not for compiling it, okay? So every machine, for all the NAV users included, every machine is having a JVM under which you are executing it, okay? You can execute any type of Java bytecode, but JVM is not sufficient for compilation. For that purpose, you need to have a separate Java compiler that is under the JDK. Okay, we'll come to that afterwards. So this nature of the bytecode, that it can be ported to some other machine and it can run over there. So that make the Java language as a platform independent language. But is Java always platform independent? Yes, it is always platform independent. Depending on which platform you're trying to run, there should be a JVM preloaded. Otherwise, it cannot run. Okay, quite obvious. Now you must be knowing what is the difference between a compiler and an interpreter. A compiler takes the whole code as it is, and after that it tries to find out if there is an error or not. So these things are known to you. A complete code is checked, after that reported the error and recompiled it. In that way, the things are going on. And for the interpreter, line by line, it checks. If the code is correct, then it is executed and gone to the next line. So if you have a code problem in fifth line, so up to the fourth line, it will be executed. So that is the difference between the compiler and interpreter. And both the concepts are used in case of Java. Source code is first compiled, normally like C. And after that, whatever intermediate code you are getting as a bytecode, so that code is actually being interpreted through the JVM. Okay, so Java is a compiled as well as interpreted language. Okay, so here from also you can get a question, is Java a compiled language or an interpreted language? Explain. So this kind of explanation you have to give. Now, under some important concepts, we need to know what is JVM. Obviously, because when we are working with Java, the Java virtual machine is the most important thing, which makes it platform independent. Okay. So we already have a little bit of idea about the virtual machine. Basically, there is OS, under which there is hardware. And normally, when an application program is written somewhere or it is going to be executed, so it directly comes under the OS, it interacts with the OS, and the requirements are going to the OS. Then via this hardware, the OS makes the things executed and then returns the result to the application program. So that happens for the normal application program execution. But in case of Java, what will happen? Here also you have the platform, that is the combo of the OS and hardware, okay? Above this OS, you have another layer, and that layer we call the JVM, Java Virtual Machine. And when you are trying to run a Java program, JP1, you are going to the JVM, Now through the JVM, the requests and everything are coming to the operating system, and through the operating system, it is being executed by the hardware. The response is going back to JVM, and from the JVM, it is coming back to the Java program. So in this way, you may run different Java programs present in your system. Let me change the color of the ink. Okay. So, suppose this JP1 was compiled on a Windows system. Suppose this JP2 was compiled in a macOS. And here, where you're trying to run it, it is a Linux. So, the platforms are different. Now, what the JVM is doing? What is an interpreter? Literally, it is working as an interpreter or intermediator. Suppose when in literal meaning you use an interpreter, suppose it's a person. So what they are actually doing? Suppose here is a person who is a Chinese. And here is a person who only knows Hindi. Now, there is an interpreter in between them. So he knows both the Chinese and the Hindi, and they are he is actually interpreting his call to the Hindi person and the Hindi person's call to the Chinese person. So this is how the interpreter is working. The JVM is also working in the same way. It is getting the information from the Windows compiled JP program 1, and it is getting the instruction and it is getting the requirement, interpreting it in terms of the Linux OS. Okay, so this internal conversions are being done by the JVM. So that is the purpose of the JVM. So where from you are coming, the JVM will interpret it in its own way, and it will be transporting the information to the corresponding OS in its understandable manner. Okay, so if the JVM is present, you need not to worry about where the program has been compiled and where it is actually executed. This nature, we are calling it WORA. That means write once, run anywhere. You are writing the code once and porting it to any kind of system, run anywhere. Okay, so this is the WORA, or platform independence. So JVM is a virtual machine. This is the normal scenario for any kind of a virtual machine, not only for the Java virtual machine. There are different other virtual machines present under the purview, and they are actually doing the same thing for different purposes. Okay, so JVM is the Java virtual machine which creates an interface through which the compiled Java code executes on any platform, that is on any hardware and operating system combination. So if a system is corresponding to, it is incorporating with JVM, it can run any Java code. I already discussed about it. Now JVM performs the following operations: load code, verifies code, executes code. That is done for any kind of interpreter. Loading the code, verifying the code, execution of the code, and that too line by line. And also provides the runtime environment. We'll come to that, what is a runtime environment. So JVM makes the communication between the runtime environment and the code possible. Okay, so these are the purpose of the JVM, and this is how the JVM is working. Now, let us come to the Java runtime environment. Java runtime environment is basically consisting of these three components. First one already we have discussed, that is your JVM. Apart from that, we have the class library. Class library is the predefined classes which are needed to be associated with your program so that the program could be executed. Because in our program, we are using various predefined classes. Likewise, in case of C, we have the header files. So here we have the class library. So class library should be associated. And after this combo will act, they will be acting with the development tool, deployment tool. So the code should be deployed to execute. So these three together makes the Java runtime environment. The Java Runtime Environment, or JRE, is a software layer that runs on the top of the computer's operating system and provides the class libraries and other resources that a specific Java program needs to run. The JRE is one of three interrelated components for developing and running Java programs. So if you are having this JRE present over here, you can easily create a Java code, because the Java development kit or JDK is also a part of the JRE. So when you have to download a Java runtime environment, in that case you will be able to compile the Java code as well. Only JVM, if you have, it can only execute the Java code. But JDK, which is a part of the Java runtime environment, if you have it, then you can compile it as well. So as a developer, you should have the Java runtime environment. Okay. So Java Virtual Machine, Java Development Toolkit, the library classes, together they will be deployed with the deployment tools, and the entire package, we call it the Java runtime environment. Now, after knowing the things, so we can move to our first Java program. So our first Java program is to print the hello world on the screen. Okay. So as I told you, first you need to create the source code. So my source code I have written under my_first_prog.java. You may see here, inside it, I have defined a class. The class is going to be defined in this way. This is the keyword. This is the keyword class, which defines that afterwards, whatever will come, this is a definition of a class. Okay, so class is a keyword. After that, you provide a name, that is the identity. We were discussing about the classes associated with state, behavior, and identity, where identity is the name. State are the different variables present under the class, and behavior are the different methods present in the class. So here, this my first prog, this is actually the name of the class, identity of the class. Okay. After that, your class definition starts with this curly braces. So this is the part, this is the block where inside your class definition is present. Inside this class, we are having our main function. Like, see, in Java also, the main function is where from the program execution starts. Okay. And main should be associated with some selective keywords, which you cannot change. Okay. What are these? Public, static, void, main. Okay. So in case of public and static, you can change as static public, but void main should be void main. So these two can be reordered, no problem. Then after that, string. String is actually a class in Java. And after that, this is a variable basically. So the name could be changed to anything, but a variable name. After that, this third brackets, which defines this variable, which is being defined over here. It's actually an array. Okay. So the name of the main function, the definition of the main function is like public static void main. After that, string args. I'm calling it args only because I have written it like that. then the braces, after that the first bracket ends, then the body of the main function started, where we have written system.out.println. This is how we print something on Java. Okay, system.out.println. Now what is this, what is that, we'll come to that afterwards. Within the println is a function, obviously you can get it. Println is a function like printf, and inside which, within double quotes, whatever you will write, that will come in the printed version. println, if you write print only, that means after printing this, the slash n will not be given. If you do not write a slash n, so by default a slash n will not be given. But if you write println, that means after writing hello world, by default there is a slash n. So that is the difference between print and println. So whatever it is, system.out.print or system.out.println, hello world, within double quotes. Okay. So this program actually enables us to print this hello world on your screen. Now, you may have a question like, do you need to have the same name for the .java file and for the class file? No, this is not mandatory. You can have any other name, but for my purpose, I have used the same name. Okay, and inside which class you have the main function, we generally call it the driver class. So this my first prog, we were going to call it the driver class. Okay, under the driver class, the main function is present. There may be other functions, there may be other attributes, whatever it is. If the main function is present under one class, so that class becomes the driver class, from which the execution starts. Okay, now when you compile it, so this is the way how we compile it. You can see in the Java folder, actually I have that my underscore first underscore prog.java, that file is present here, and I have called this Java C command that is invoking the compiler. Okay, Java compiler is invoked by Java C space the name of my source code. Got it? Now after pressing an enter, if it is listing a number of errors, that means you have the error and you have to correct it. After that, you correct your code and again try to recompile, and you can see it is a successful compilation. So after this, directly the next prompt came and there is no notification about any error. So the program was error free. Then you have to run it. So for execution, what we call the Java command. Okay, so Java command is basically invoking the JVM. Java space the dot class file that was created after compilation of this code. So if you have compiled this code, how many class files you are going to get here after successful compilation?
The number of classes in the file, ma'am. The number of classes defined in the file.
How many classes here? How many classes here?
One class.
Just one. So you will get just one dot class file, and what is going to be the name of the dot class file?
The class name.
My underscore first underscore prog dot class in this case. If you don't give the same name of this name, suppose you have given class A, so you are going to have A dot class. Okay. Now, while executing your code, after this Java, give the name of your driver class. Got it? In this case, the name of the driver class is the same of the .java file's name, as I have done it in this way. But if you have suppose you don't give this name here, you have given A, class A, okay? In that case, after compilation, you'll be getting A dot class. And that A dot class is actually your driver class, because under A dot class you have the main function. So while you are executing it, you write Java, then space, then A. Don't need to write dot class. Do not write it. Okay. So Java space the name of your driver class. That's it. Now if you press enter, on the next line you can see the output has come. Okay. And then you move to the next prompt. So this is how the Java programs are compiled and executed.
Ma'am, what is the meaning of static in public static void main?
I'll come to that. Our next slide is about that. But before going to that, now as we don't have any lab classes right now, so do not think that the lab classes will wait forever. Try to download the JDK. It's very safe and simply you can download it from Oracle. So download the JDK and try to run all the programs that I'm showing here and all other programs that you get in the internet. Okay. So that will be beneficial for you. Otherwise, it will be difficult to understand everything about Java. So now get to your program. Our first Java program was containing a very difficult thing, that is public static void main. What are these? Now, simple thing first. Main, it is the name of your main function. Void main is not returning anything, so indicates that the return type of the main function, it is void. So main doesn't return anything, not even a null. If you return a null, that means you are returning something. If you return a zero, that means also you are returning something. But here we are writing void. That means main will return nothing. Okay. Now here comes the most interesting thing, that is static. We were discussing something about static. For this static, your Java is not becoming a purely object-oriented language. So main itself is a static. Now, what is the virtue of static? If you declared some variable or function or method, okay, here main is a method. So if you declare something as static, you need not to create object of the governing class to call that particular method or variable from outside the class. So I'm giving just a simple example here. Suppose you have a class A under which you have a static int small a and you have a normal int a. Sorry, int b. Okay. Now, if you try to call this A from outside the class, say from class B, you have got a function ABC. Okay, from here, you are trying to call the value of this A. So what you have to write? As it is static, you can directly write A dot small a. You can refer like this. So there will be no problem. But if you try to do the same thing like this for B, it is not possible because B is not a static variable. So to access B, what you have to do, you have to instantiate instance of capital A, you have to create, suppose it is A1. So A1 dot B, that way you can access the value of B. So it is a static variable or static method. You need not to take the help of a object to call it from outside the class. But if it is a static, then what you have to do? With the class name itself, you have to access it. So if you write capital A dot small a, what does that mean? The capital A is the name of the class inside which there should be a static variable whose name is small a, and that you are trying to access. So if you try to access main from outside the class, suppose this is the case. Suppose this is the case. Okay. And you're trying to access main from outside the class. What you should write? Do you need to have a object of my first prog to be created?
No.
To call main? No. Main is static. So if you want to call main, what you have to write? My first prog dot main. Okay, so what will be the advantage of main being a static? See, when from your program is actually starting its execution, you are not getting a chance to create object of a class, and after that, through the object, you are trying to call the main function. You are not getting the chance to create the object. because the first thing is to call the main function. Inside main, you are starting execution. Before calling main, you are not having any chance to do anything. Okay, so if main is not a static method, then how can you call it initially? So that is why main is static. If main is static, then you can call it with the name of the class. MyFirstProg.main you can call, isn't it? So you can see the JVM is taking only one information, the name of the driver class. So that with this name, it will just write the name dot main and the main function will be called. Got your answer? Why main is static? Okay. Otherwise, it will not be possible to call the main function for the very first time. Without calling the main function, you are not going to do anything with your Java code. So when you are going to create the first class object through which you are calling the main function, you are not going to get any chance for that. Okay. So the static is here. Static keyword permits to access the class component without creating object of the respective class. Okay, got your thing? Then comes the public. Public means we were discussing about the security of Java, and there are the different kinds of security present over there. A data or a method can be only used inside the class itself, can be used in the family of the class where this class is related with, can be used by anybody. Okay, so there are the different levels of security. Now this public is a keyword which basically associated with the highest or the lowest level of security. Lowest level means accessible by anybody from inside the class, from outside the class, from the family, from outside the family, from the package, from outside the package, from the operating system which is not included in the JVM. So from anywhere you can call the associated method or variable if they are declared as public. So public access specifier in Java that grants permission to everyone to access the related component from anywhere. So JVM is actually the caller of your main function. JVM is not belonging to the class. JVM is not belonging within the family. JVM is not belonging even within the package. So you should have given the most reluctant kind of access specifier for the purpose of the main calling. It should be called from outside the environment. So that means the main is needed to be public. Okay, so main is needed to be public. Main is needed to be static. Main is not returning anything, so it is void return type. Its name is main. After that, this portion is for the command line argument passing. You can see this args, whatever may be the name, you can change this name also. Nothing will be problem over there if you change the name. So instead, we can write string A, or even you can write string bracket A. So all means the same. Whatever be the name, this is a variable, so you can change the name for this. You can alter the order of the static and public. Public static or static public will not change anything. Cannot change this void or the position of the void. Cannot change main or the position of the main. Cannot change string. It should be string, nothing else. Okay? So basically, the data type through which the Java takes input and output, it is always a string. Afterwards, the data is going to be modified in some other shape. But initially, whatever it is taking as input or output, it needs to be string. Here also, we are taking an array of the string. So whenever you are executing the code, suppose you have written Java, then suppose your driver class's name is driver. And after that, on the command line, if you provide some other argument like A, B, C, D, like 1, 2, 3, 4, like AB 1, 2, this way. So these are the command line arguments, and you can see this is one string, this is another string, this is another string. Even if it is only containing numbers, this will also be treated like a string. So these strings are coming to this keyword, sorry, this variable name, the array. The array will be holding these values inside it when from the command line you are passing them. So this is actually your args 0, this is args 1, this is args 2. So that way the things are represented. Okay. So is it clear? Command line argument will be discussing afterwards also. But public static void main string args, what are the significance of the different keywords? Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Ma'am, can you repeat the public term?
Public. So there are different levels of access specification. Okay. One is within the class. Then the next level is within the family. Family means one class is related with other classes. So within the family, if you want to share some data, so that will be the second level of access. The third level is within the package, means within the same folder where the class is residing. The next level is from anywhere. Even if from the operating system, even if from the JVM, who are not belonging to this family and the package and all. Okay. So public means to this last level, from anywhere. So if you declare something as public, you can use it from inside the class, you can use it within the family, you can use it within the package, and you can use it from anywhere. From different packages, from different classes, from anywhere. Public means open to all. Okay. Main, you have to declare as public, as the caller of the main is the JVM, who is not belonging to the class itself, who is not belonging to the class's family, which is not belonging to the package of the same class. Okay. So JVM is actually completely an outsider who is trying to call the main. And the main needs to be public for that purpose. Okay. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
And this is our last slide for today. These things are already known to you. So I just have to go through the slides. Data types in Java, there are two types of data. One is the primitive data type. So these are the integer and all that you have already heard of in C, C++, etc. So these are the primitive predefined data types for which you need not to create object. Directly, like C, just write int A and the A variable will behave like integer. Okay. And there are non-primitive data types. And there are non-primitive data types for the string, array, etc. These are actually going to be non-primitive data types. And any other class and class object you are using, so these are the non-primitive data types. So under the primitive data types, what we have for the character presentation, we have the char, like C. For integer, there are different levels of integer, byte, short, int, long. Byte is 1 byte, short 2 byte, int 4 byte, and long 8 byte. Floating point, two different types, float and double. By default, double is taken for the real number representation. By default, double will be taken. So if you just write 2.15, that 2.15 will behave like a double. But if you want to make it to behave like a float, then you have to write something like this, 2.15 float. Okay. So you have to forcefully make it float. Otherwise, the data are always double. Boolean, this is how we declare Boolean. Boolean, unlike x, two values, true and false. 2 and 1, but Boolean test true and false. So these are the primitive data types that are present in Java, and we are going to use them for our purpose. We have string and array. We will be discussing it afterwards. So I'm stopping today here because our time is already complete. And one more thing, if you want to join the class, please join within 5 minutes. Otherwise, I will not allow. Answer to the roll call. From 1 to 10, who are there?
Roll 3, ma'am.
Okay. Roll 2, ma'am.
No, roll 10.
After 3, 3, 4, 5,
7, ma'am, 7.
6, 7, okay.
Yes,
8, 9, 10.
Yes, ma'am.
11.
Yes, ma'am. 12.
13.
Yes, 14. Ma'am.
15. 16. 17.
Yes, ma'am.
18. 17.
Yes, ma'am. 17.
18. 18. 18. 19. 20.
Again, ma'am.
21, 22, 23, 24.
Yes, ma'am.
23 present, ma'am.
Is there?
Yes, ma'am.
25.
Yes, ma'am.
25.
26. Yes, ma'am.
26. 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39.
Yes, ma'am.
40, 41.
Yes, ma'am. 41. Yes, ma'am.
42.
Present, ma'am. 42.
43.
Present, ma'am.
44.
Present, ma'am.
45. 46.